first YouTube Live event. It's going to be a bit more informal than you guys are used to, but we figured we'd share a little bit of the process, both with the painting and a little bit of behind the scenes with the time lapse. So I think we'll just go ahead and get started. I don't know if anybody's on yet. Nobody's on yet. We're talking to nobody except for YouTube. Oh, great. Okay. Mm-hmm, so for those of you who are just joining, we're going to do some painting. This is our first YouTube Live event, so it's a little more informal than you guys might be used to. But,
I'm scared.
Yeah, he's nervous, so if he talks like that the whole time, whatever. But we'll do some painting, and we'll do some behind the scenes on like how we do camera work and stuff like that. So, Ryan, you want to get started? Show them what we're going to do?
Yeah, sure. So I know you guys love our cheap tools. I've got my $15 Harbor Freight piece of junk detail gun.
We bought this at Harbor Freight about... what, 25 minutes ago?
But to be fair, I also bought it like a year ago.
That's
and
true.
4 years ago,
yeah.
And it's a Harbor Freight tool, so it's just going to break and you keep
yeah.
getting a new one. It's not that we don't have nice stuff. I have this nice DeVilva spray gun. It's the wrong tool for the job here, so we're not going to use it. This has the advantage of, if I can get that position back in a nice place, the cup can swing different ways and stuff. It's still gravity feed. It's really small, so I can get into tight areas and all that.
Yeah, they usually call this, what, a door jam gun?
Yeah, door jam gun, detail gun, touch-up
yeah.
gun, something like that. All the same thing. If you're just starting out painting, I actually think this is a good idea. It takes some of the trouble out of what they call HVLP, high volume, low pressure. You have less control over the paint with that kind of gun, so it takes a little more practice
and
to get
there. It
tends
to put out a lot of paint at once.
It does.
That's the high volume.
Yeah, and you know, getting it with no orange peel and all that sort of stuff is really difficult. Plus, you got to have a lot of compressor to go.
And in our case, the biggest piece we're painting today is this guy, and that's Bloody Swan for this.
And you'll notice it has a lot of like goofy little curves and undercut things
yep.
and stuff like that that are exactly why you want a spray gun like this.
So we'll talk about the plan real quick as far as the setup here. It looks a little different from the last episode when we were painting because we're going to be moving a lot of pieces around. We've got everything set up here. We're not going to be painting here. This is just going to move stuff over here. If you want to back up,
mm-hmm.
I'll show you. By the way, Dima's on camera today, so
hi guys.
Say hi to the people. So yeah, we're going to be moving stuff over here and painting, and then I'll move it back very carefully, wearing gloves, and not touching the paint, of course. And this allows us to paint without getting any overspray on stuff, because as soon as we start painting, this whole place is going to get a little foggy. So.
Yeah.
I want to say hi to England and Ireland checking out.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Do we have any, if you guys have any questions on what we're doing, feel free to ask. I think you guys can ask us.
I'll be reading them off to them so they can answer the questions
awesome.
For you.
Yeah. Let me get some gloves.
Yeah. So step one of these things, you got to kind of set up the gun itself. I get the little nozzle facing so that it's up and down because that's how I like to paint. Tighten that in real good. I've got just a little bit of lacquer thinner in here. Really simple, the three controls. This is air pressure, this is your pattern, so like fan versus a narrow thing, and then this is both how far the trigger pulls back, which is also how much paint comes out. So if I do a little bit there, you can see, and I want like a pretty wide fan here.
Oh, we got people from Northern Germany.
Yeah. Someone asked earlier where the clones are.
They're all in the elevator pit.
So yeah, you can see that narrows it up a bunch. If I back it out the other way, then I should get a little bit more of a fan. And that's pretty good to me.
Romania, nice. Can everybody hear us all right, by the way?
Yeah, a little too much pressure and paint flow.
And Ryan's just doing this kind of visually, trying not to do it right over the
the
painted
yeah.
bits. Well, I also have a board here if you want to check spray pattern, if you want to just paint against that. Once we get the paint flowing.
Well, actually, very little paint coming out of this right now, so can you see that board?
Yep.
Go ahead and do it. And you probably can't see that on camera because it's real pale, but
yep.
it's just enough I can kind of see how wet it is.
Yep.
All right. I should do it, so.
Let's talk about a little bit of paint mixing, shall we? You got that?
Welcome, Holland.
Thanks.
Hank from Holland.
That's just removing the lacquer. If you don't pull all the lacquer out of there, the first shot you do with paint's gonna be a little thin.
Well, it's gonna be lacquer too, and you don't want that to dissolve your whatever you got on there.
All right, so automotive paint is mixed in different parts. So this stuff, it takes a reducer to thin the paint. and a hardener, which is kind of what makes this paint special, and it's the reason that it's much more high quality than spray paint, is that hardener will get the paint, you know, rock hard like steel. So that's what we're doing. And this stuff is a metallic, you got to mix it up real good. If you want to get in there close, you can see what he's doing.
You see, it starts out real black like that, and then once it starts to get all the stuff off the bottom, you start seeing that silver come into it.
Yep.
Isn't that neat?
So the ratio for this paint is, it's 8 parts paint, 2 parts reducer, and 1 part hardener. The reducer's already mixed up in this, so you can leave reducer and paint for probably a year. It's not a big deal. But if you put the hardener in now, you'd come back to a solid lump of paint in the next day or two. So you gotta mix that up right on the spot. And you gotta use all the paints that you mix up, because it'll be finished after that.
Yep. Anything else is waste.
So this is acrylic, what is it, acrylic epoxy?
It's acrylic enamel.
Enamel, yeah.
Enamel's good because it's very chemical resistant and it gets very, very hard.
Yep.
You can dissolve it, which we'll do later when we go to clean the gun. By the way, Mike, with the cleaning the stuff.
Dougie's
on, all right.
What's up, Doug?
Mike did a great job painting while I was away. You probably wondered why it was that, you know, his brother had all this nice paint gun, but he's not a painter. I was out of town.
Yeah.
But he did a really good job. The only things that I can complain about are, you know, he sucks at cleaning things.
Yeah.
It was no problem. I mean, it only sat on there for a week or something, so it all came off.
Shout out to Doug and Guard Dog Vals,
by
the way.
Yeah.
Can't wait for that Kickstarter to start. You guys will be hearing more about that later.
That's right.
So, because this is already mixed up at an 8-to-2 ratio for the reducer, that means there's 10 parts in there and we need 1 part hardener. We're actually going to spike the hardener a bit. That's a trick to get really, really hard paint. So you put 30-40% extra hardener in there.
Mm-hmm. So I'm going to put about 4 ounces in here.
So this is usually where, like, my heart starts racing a little bit. I'm sure it's just because there's a lot to think about, and I don't do it very often. Ryan's a bit more experienced.
Yeah, there definitely is, like, many things that can go wrong in painting. One of them is if you put the top back onto this thing. Because hardener will harden up by itself.
It will. So you got it. Okay.
A little bit scary, but... So you got all this stuff. That is hardener that has turned into gel.
Okay. All right, while Ryan's mixing that up, I'm going to go ahead and set up a time lapse for the episode that you guys will see in a little while.
Welcome, Seattle.
Hey, right. Seattle.
So if you guys haven't watched the episode on how I built this thing, definitely go check that out. You've seen it used quite a lot in the episode so far, but this may be the first time you're actually seeing it work. So if you're curious about it, go back and check it out. It's in season 1.
It looks like we're having maybe a little trouble with connection. It says poor connection.
Poor connection? Okay. Can you guys see okay? Is it getting choppy?
Yeah, let us know if you guys can see and hear everything okay.
You may need to stay to that part of the garage because we're on Wi-Fi right now. Okay. Time-lapse. This nice and slow.
Someone says it's probably going to be the paint fumes making your heart beat faster.
Quite possibly.
That's where we got the masks and stuff.
Yeah.
Alright, time lapse is going. This thing moves really slow so that when we speed the whole thing up in time lapse, you get a nice smooth motion. So, as long as I don't knock that over, that should be good to go. Alright, and I'm just going to be on moving part duty and cable management, I guess, for lack of a better word.
Going to be on, chemical duty, I guess.
So, you're all mixed up, we're ready to go?
Yeah, I think so. So, you know, safety first, this stuff is really nasty, like, not good to breathe. All three of us have masks on.
Yep. Camera lady's got a mask on.
Camera lady's got a mask on. Okay, I'll put that on there. Okay, I'm going to pour a little bit into here.
Yeah, the one thing about the small detail guns is they don't have much capacity, so we're going to have to refill a few times.
Yeah, I would think so, but, you know, the good news is that, like, it's very efficient. You know, if you think about how fast the spray can goes down, this is much, much more efficient. So.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
fill it up or anything?
No, I really only put it about halfway, and that's just so that I don't end up filling a whole bunch of it at once. At one point I was painting a car a couple of years ago, I think I was using primer. I got through the whole thing, it was all perfect. I went to go put the gun away, and I was still in the hose, and like took back down and poured all down my arm. Yeah. Fussy people, you know.
Nice. You guys may not be able to tell, but we've got the garage door open behind us a little bit with a fan pointing out to try to help ventilate. It's not going to do a fantastic job. It is going to get a little foggy in here, but that's why we're all wearing masks. It's a combination between airflow and your paint adjustment and how much paint it pulls through.
Yep. Oh, it's going to bring them in.
All right.
All right, which one do you want to do first?
Either way.
All right. I guess we'll just start over here and work our way around. This is actually still coming on pretty light, so. The nice thing about the detail gun, like as you change angles, you can kind of switch that top around.
At some point, the air compressor is going to kick on here, and you're not going to be able to hear us. So if you have any questions, now would be the time to ask. So the other thing is you're really only getting about 10% of the work here. So much of the work is done before paint. Definitely stay tuned for the episode where we show a lot of the truck work and how that went. That should be posted in the next day or two.
You notice I kind of spray like half whatever it is that I'm doing. And that's because like the moment you pull the trigger, it's a higher pressure than once it starts flowing. So you kind of want it to go nice and even. And of course, if you like stopped on it anywhere, you would end up, you know, making the next five.
Well, we're not going to be able to hear it. We might get people dropped off. Yeah. Because is that the famous purple metallic Harbor Freight gun?
What's that?
They're asking if it's the famous purple Harbor Freight gun. It is.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Sorry if we dropped off for a minute there.
Focus for connection.
Not sure
what. What pressure is this?
We're asking what pressure.
I'm running about 30 psi.
So about 30 psi. I apologize if the audio is pretty bad. We got the air compressor running.
Flip it, and then we'll, still got plenty of paint in there right now, too. It's going to go nice and slow.
Yeah, you're putting it down a whole lot thinner than I was.
Yeah. Well, I just want to make sure we don't end up with any runs or anything like that.
Yep.
But, you know, I'm also kind of adjusting as I go here. Like, I'm getting a little more comfortable with how much paint this puts out.
Alright.
Okay.
Mike says, I hope you like that color. Everything in your garage is going to have a veil on it.
That is probably true.
Yeah.
Now, I wouldn't normally recommend moving parts around when there's wet paint. No, ideally, you'd want it all set up so you could paint it in one shot. We just don't have really enough room, and, you know, maybe hanging it up on the garage would do pretty well, but I think we're going to do okay here. There's enough parts that are masked that I can pull it up without messing anything up. Yeah, you don't have to get... Oh, yeah. You get some of that on the side. Yeah, there's enough to think about when you're just painting. To add on top of that, we got to move parts around, we got to film a YouTube live event, and an episode for YouTube later on. I'm glad there's three of us here. You guys saw me struggling in the last video doing it by myself.
We have a comment from Jake saying, I'd love to have a garage like that. He works out of an 8x8 shed.
We started there too. We used to have a garage back in the day where it's just like a little add-on to your apartment complex. And it was probably about an 8x8. We repainted motorcycles in that. We did quite a lot, but we're very lucky to have this space.
Oh, yeah. Definitely a long time coming. Yeah, I remember it was small enough that if you parked the car in it, it was hard to get out of the car.
Yep.
But we still don't have the car now, so.
Yep. Our first CNC that we ever built, now we haven't talked about CNC machines much on this channel yet, but our very first CNC we actually built in an apartment complex. Terrible idea.
And we had a great idea.
The pieces are going to get a little harder because they're going to get heavier. I'm starting with the small stuff, but...
Small stuff is actually harder to paint, but, easier to move, of course.
You guys want to take a look here and get a little bit of a close-up to the paint. It's coming out pretty nice.
This piece is going to come out really nice.
You guys that are watching, I don't know if many of you are painters, but maybe you can share some stories. What are the craziest things you've ever painted? Craziest situations, biggest mistakes? Anything like that. Show them the time-lapse camera slowly running over there. But you might be thinking, like, is it a smart idea to have a nice expensive camera in the middle of this room with paint fumes? The answer is no, it is not. But I do it for you guys, so...
By the way, one of the big disadvantages of the famous purple gun.
Oh, yeah.
You see all this stuff that comes down from under there. It's just, like, not a very good seal, you know? So, they got messed up. No big deal. For $15, you can buy 10 of them. Of course, you can buy that developer's for you.
Jake shared a story saying he was driving home with a lathe one day, heard a thump, and realized that his lathe was gone by the time.
Oh, no!
Oh, no.
Terrible.
Golly.
Yeah, you gotta tie those suckers down.
They don't seem like they're going anywhere when they're sitting still, right?
You gotta think about how you're gonna pick it up without touching anything that needs to be painted. It's a little tricky, but I think I can do it.
Brian's asking, what do you have planned for the first Warriors project?
That's a very good question. You know, we've been thinking about that for a little while. We haven't settled on anything just yet, but if you guys have any suggestions, please write down in the comments to the video or in this, that would be awesome. Oh my gosh, a 400 gallon vat, what was it? There we go. And a red zinc coating. Old school solvent base. Oh, kitty litter to the rescue, yeah. That is a mess. This is like the main reason we use the detail gun. Trying to get in these little faces with that big developer should be almost impossible. You can't read it, a little bit of paint here, but it's full acryl. Two, it's acrylic enamel. It's very, very tough. It uses a hardener that gets it very hard. You can even spike it with a little bit of hardener, which is what we did at the beginning of this. So it comes out probably harder than the steel it paints on. This particular color is actually called violet. It's made for a Winnebago. Mm.
We have a question from Jake asking, how old is the lathe? And how much does it cost?
So the lathe, this was, I believe it's a 1964 Colchester Bantam. And we paid about $200 for it, which is an absolute steal.
Yeah, it was in bad, bad shape. If you go back and look at our first video, you'll see it was rough.
How much did the paint cost?
The paint was probably about half of that price.
Yeah.
Especially with all the support equipment that you need just set up for it, it's probably not worth it. But we had most of the stuff sitting around.
Thanks, Mike. Great comment. Says, I've painted for 35 years plus, everything from aircrafts to high-rise buildings, and you guys are doing a great job.
Awesome. Thanks. That means a lot to us.
Yeah. We grew up around a bunch of old paintings, and we still did, classic cars and everything, and man, the quality of work that, old craftsmen do. Forever respect, you know?
Absolutely. So we're getting heavier and heavier as the pieces go, because the last two pieces we're just going to leave here, because they're just too heavy to move around. It's going to take two of us to get the gearbox over. And this one's going to be tricky, because I got to turn it over as soon as Ryan's done with this side.
We have Mark asking, what brand is the lathe?
The brands are Colchester Bantam. Now, Colchester made lathes for a long time under a different name, too. I don't remember the...
Clausing. C-L-A-U-S-I-N-G.
So they're I believe, a British company. At least the Colchester is. I think they may have had a sister company. But it's the same way. They made them all the way up until, I think, the early
90s. Past my
Let me know when you want me to flip that guy.
Just looking at everything that I can. Okay, let's see if I got it. Nice and clean looking.
One thing people don't realize about painting, if you've never done it, I think it's kind of a relaxing process, but you notice both Ryan and I are sweating pretty good. And I'm just moving the parts around. This is actually a lot more physical work.
Yeah, it's certainly dandy. I don't mind the physical part of it. It's just, it's Florida. It's about 90 degrees in here.
That's true.
I'm wearing a tie-dye suit, so go ahead and roll on over.
So, anyone that just cringed when they saw me pick up painted parts, I was very careful to only pick up the parts that were masked off. That paint's going to get peeled up. There's just masking tape underneath it.
We've got someone from Hand Tool Rescue asking, but where does the meat go?
That's a different channel. You have to tune in later for the answer to that one. You see, one thing Ryan has to be really careful of, you see these drips, that's coming off the front of the gun.
Yeah, you see it all over my trigger finger there.
That's the biggest thing you got to watch out for with these Sheep Harbor Freight guns.
Yeah.
I'm sure it'll get me somewhere in this.
All right.
Let's go over to, I think this is our
second to last piece, so we got one more. We're doing all right on paint?
We're doing great on paint. I just refilled a couple minutes ago. So, I mean, you can see,
I put it
about halfway. Paint the last couple of parts. So I basically used almost the full cup of this by the time I'm done. Excuse me.
Okay. A very good question on the motor. Ryan Deal, thank you. Yeah, we got one on order, finally. It'll be here on Tuesday. We went with a 1 horsepower. It's a little underpowered compared to the stock motor that was in here. I think you had either a 1 horsepower or 1.5 horsepower option when you bought it. And we went with a 1 horsepower, mostly for the price. But it is a 3-phase. It'll run on 220 volt. With a VFD, for those of you that don't know, VFD stands for variable frequency drive. It allows us to do things like slow down the motor and and do emergency stops without real high power relays because it's all handled in one box. We'll do a whole video on VFDs in a little while.
Mark is asking, how much was the paint gun?
Paint gun was $15?
Yep.
So this is not out of reach. If you have an air compressor at home, $15 investment with a little bit of paint, buy the cheapest car paint you can when you're starting because you're going to screw up. Don't paint anything you love either.
Honestly, just put lacquer thinner through it to start with or something so you can see the patterns you're making and stuff like that.
Absolutely.
You know, paint an old piece of wood.
Yeah.
You'll make mistakes, and that's fine, you know. I mean, gee, we'll make a lot of mistakes.
And anybody out there with a garage that doesn't have an air compressor, I highly recommend you get one. You won't look back. And then, you know, an initial investment isn't too bad. You'll get a little cheap one. It'll do the job for most things you're going to use it for.
Yeah. If you get anything that's HVLP, you'll need a big air compressor because it'll run through it really quick.
But these little Harbor Freight guns don't take a lot of air.
No.
Not much paint coming through.
Yeah. Well, I'm kind of cupping it too so that if it drips,
okay,
it doesn't go under the part.
Yeah. Okay, there we go. Any risk of these guns getting clogged, Ryan?
Yeah. Yeah, they're cheap guns. I mean, there's everything in the world wrong with them, but they still put out a decent pattern, so that's really all you got to worry about. I think my pressure might be just a bit too high, too.
It looks like there's not much paint coming through.
Yeah, I'm thinking of my impression too. Look, and there we go.
So we got a drip. Now, if you got a drip, don't try and wipe it up. Just leave it. It's going to be okay. You'll be able to sand it flat if need be. This is actually the back of the part, so I'm not too concerned with it. But
someone's asking, how clean was the workshop before you started painting?
Not as clean as it will be when we're done. Yeah, no, I mean, workshop around here is never particularly clean. That's something we got to work on. But yeah, you're going to end up with a thin layer of overspray everywhere. That's pretty unavoidable.
Pretty clogged.
All right.
We might need to just kind of whip some of this down. And
yep. Sounds like we got a bit of a clog.
Yeah.
That's okay. Good. You're going to get a chance to see what it takes to unclog it.
So step one, get the paint out of it.
You still putting down paint on this one? I guess we're not moving it, so.
Yeah, we're not moving it.
Okay.
That will dry out a little bit on there, but I just need something to do. Stop holding all this for.
Hello, Italy. We got someone from Italy watching.
Oh, nice. Hello, Italy.
Wait, who knows the time?
Bonjour.
Close enough.
Nozzle's definitely stuck. Can you grab me a wrench out of here, Mike? I'm thinking it's about a 12, 13, something like that.
Here's a 13. I think you're smaller than that. That's it. Alright. I love you.
So what typically causes a clog in one of these guns, eh?
Usually there's something, you know, a piece of the spring will latch up in a way. You have too much stuff on it, and you end up in something like that.
We want to just pull the air out.
Yeah. Disconnect. You see some, you know, they've got like silicone or something around the back of this to try to seal it. It's a little bit of a mess. At least the needle looks like it is coming out of the thing a little bit.
Maybe just spray some lacquer through it?
Yeah, that's kind of what I'm thinking. It doesn't look like there's anything like really that leaks too far into the back of the gun. But, you know, there really never should be. The seal, it has to run all the way down that trigger thing to get there.
Where's the aircraft painter guy? Tell us what to do!
Yeah, right? That's interesting.
Is that because the front is on?
No, it's because this guy... Well, it should be because this guy isn't quite normal, right? But I think, let's just go on. Put a little more pressure on and hit the actual... Just go from there. Okay, I'll put some through it. Hopefully it'll unclog. Worst case, we're down to our two big parts.
Try not to spray this direction.
wouldn't do it now. I'm not ready. I'm not spinning back over anymore.
If anybody, you know, you get regular subscribers that have been watching the channel for a while, you'll know we're not shy about making mistakes, so, you know, stuff happens here, you know, you just gotta roll with it, especially in this situation where you can't do much. Now, we've got a backup gun, because this sort of thing can happen, mm-hmm. And you'd rather switch over and not waste paint and have two guns to clean than to throw away a bunch of paint.
Gotta loosen that up, not the other way, side to side.
Cross that, yep.
Okay. Down the nozzle. I don't think there's even a seal in that one.
There we go.
Hey, there it is.
Back in business.
All right. So I gotta get rid of this. You got another cup that I can pour this into?
Yep, I'll grab you one. It may melt this.
It will melt that.
So this will be a fun experiment. Yeah, you'll see our mixing cup is specifically designed to mix paint. This is just a cheap Publix cup. Lack of thinner may melt it. Looks alright though.
We've got a comment saying to avoid clogs, material should always be run through a strainer when pouring it in the cup.
And that is a very good point.
It's a good idea.
We bought filters. Where are they?
We're sitting over there on that bench.
We also have an idea for the next episode.
Sitting on the, where you got the wrench, Mike?
Oh, yes.
You probably had to move them out of the way to get a wrench.
I probably did.
There we go. See.
Look at that. Whoa.
We're terrible.
Oh,
that's
boy.
Right. That should do it.
Okay. That's a mess. Everything always goes wrong at the very end.
Yeah.
Good suggestion, though.
That looks a little bit more right.
Future episodes include why we built a pain booth.
You laugh, but that's a possibility.
Yeah, I wouldn't be against it. Usually if I'm doing a car, I rent a paint booth. And then that gets it through, but... Wow, that's so much nicer.
Alright, last piece. We're going to need Brian to help moving it. You want to set that right down? This is where it gets real tricky. This thing probably weighs 120 pounds. Not anything that much, but it's not mine.
Hi, Argentina.
The other thing is, it doesn't like to sit very flat either. Okay,
feels good there.
Yep.
Okay,
here's
one this one just popped.
Yeah, and you know, one of the big things, I've talked about this before, paint is all about prep. You gotta prep And that's not only the surface and the primer and all that stuff. It's really working through your process. You want to rehearse a few times because, I mean, the first time we did this on the last video when I was painting primer, I didn't rehearse nearly enough and everything went wrong. So, you know, this time we walked through 3 or 4 times exactly the orchestration, how we were going to move things. And it's made a big difference.
Even with things going wrong, right?
Yeah, no doubt. And yeah, I'll try and reduce our paint mess here.
Just now with my hands all sweaty, you need to draw a blood. You're not going to roll around. This is machine surface, not of this?
Yeah. All of this is machine, but it's not masked. We're painting it.
Okay. That's right. That was the section when you kind of discovered the machine.
Yep.
You're supposed to see a little bit of the grain pattern when you hit silver on it. Yep.
Camera, you'll be in the next video. Take a look.
Anything looks too dry or anything like that. And that goes for any piece that you touch.
Anything that's orange is masking, that doesn't need to be painted. Everything else looks great.
Alright.
Alright. Well, back over here, Ryan. Let me just squeeze between there. Selfie this up too, get it both out soon. Well, really appreciate you guys joining. I hope you enjoyed it. First YouTube live event, I think it went pretty well. So, thanks for all the stories and suggestions. Really appreciate it. We're gonna get some fresh air. See you on the next one.
All right.